Hello, everyone, and welcome to Beneath the Surface. This is a new monthly series of presentations from the Australian National Maritime Museum. I'm Emily Jateff, the Curator of Ocean Science and Technology here at the museum. Before we begin, on behalf of the museum, I would like to acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation as the traditional custodians of the Bamul and Badu, or earth and waters, of the land on which we live and work. We also acknowledge all traditional custodians throughout Australia and pay our respects to them, their cultures, and their elders, past and present. Today's presentation will last for about 40 minutes, and you are welcome to ask questions throughout. Please type them into the chat box on the screen. We will also have 20 minutes for discussion at the end. Our presenters today are me and Derek Ellard, CEO of Go Sails Cargo. I'll set the scene for us first, and then Derek will join us for the Q&A session. So why are we talking about sustainable shipping today? Well, the museum has committed to a 10-year program in support of the UN Decade of Ocean Science for Sustainable Development. While the museum's current exhibition, One Ocean, Our Future, provides a broad brush look at the challenges facing the ocean today, it can't and shouldn't cover everything. Changes within the shipping and transport industry are vital to our growing blue economy and a healthy future ocean. Therefore, it is important that as part of our 10-year program, we ensure we introduce and share with our audiences as many aspects of sustainable ocean futures as humanly possible. So this talk will explore historic modes of ship propulsion and relate them to recent innovations for more environmentally friendly marine transport. We look at how the industry is retrofitting and designing new vessels to minimize these risks with a focus on wind power. Derek will discuss the future of the shipping sector and development of modern electric clipper ships. So the International Maritime Organization estimates that between 2007 and 2012, the world's marine fleet consumed between 250 and 325 million tons of fuel, contributing approximately 2.8% of annual global greenhouse gas and 3.1% of CO2 annual emissions. It has been said that if the shipping industry were a country, it would be ranked between Germany and Japan as the sixth largest contributor to CO2 emissions. The shipping industry needs to reduce its emissions by 50% by 2050. Like aviation, marine shipping is not covered under the Paris Agreement. So this target is mandated by the IMO. Even this target is considered questionable by some scientists who state that this is aligned to global warming of 3 degrees, not 1.5 degrees as set by the Paris Agreement. To achieve true parity, the IMO would need to set a target of reducing emissions by 1/3 in 2030 and achieve net zero by 2050. How does the IMO hope to achieve these goals? Speed reduction to save fuel consumption, use of kites and sails while at sea, connecting to electricity in port, and the rollout of zero emission fuels like hydrogen and ammonia are some of the factors under consideration. But first, let's take a quick and brief look at some of the pollutants that the shipping sector is trying to reduce. Air pollution. This is caused by exhaust gases emitted from vessels, primarily diesel engines powered by high sulfur fuel oil or bunker oil. Ultra-low sulfur fuel, or ULSD, has been developed and is now in use primarily in Europe and North America. The IMO has recently instituted, in 2020, new regulations around the use of high-emitting fuels for ships. Other options include ammonia, hydrogen, and liquefied natural gas. However, a new study says that ULSD and LNG do not have any measurable positive impact on seepage of carbon dioxide emissions into the environment, but I'm sure that some of you would take umbrage at that. Now, this is water pollution. Now, this can come from various sources. Ballast water, which can contain animals, plants, viruses, and bacteria, Their release into the environment is controlled through global and national regulations. In 2004, the IMO adopted the International Convention for the Control and Management of Ships' Ballast Water and Sediments, which is managed through a certificate program and a record book. Water pollutants can also be found in ships' wastewater, black water, or gray water, which can be managed through membrane bioreactors, bilge water, and solid waste disposal. Acoustic pollution is noise pollution, which can have a detrimental effect on marine mammals or any animals that navigate or communicate through sound. One of the best methods for managing acoustic pollution is diversion around or reduction of speed through known biologically sensitive areas. The difficulty here is, of course, that you cannot force marine mammals to stay in the known biologically sensitive area, and that we still don't have a really crystal clear picture of the effects of acoustic pollution on marine species. So we are going to briefly gaze back into history by looking at wind propulsion, one of the earliest and best methods of traveling across the seas. Sails effectively harvest the kinetic energy of the wind. While they can harness the wind to cover vast distances, wind power ships were eventually replaced by fuel powered ships because wind power on its own was reliable and slow. According to the International Windship Association, the shipping industry is increasingly convinced that wind power is a renewable energy source with a viable future within various sectors of the global shipping fleet. However, wind-powered ships of the future need to include some sort of environmentally friendly backup engine and high-tech design elements to create a wind-powered vessel that is as reliable and fast as a conventional bunker fuel. I'm having trouble with my words today. Conventional bunker oil-fueled freighter. To achieve a 50% cut, we need to get wind turbines and batteries to store the energy they produce and alternative fuels onto these vessels sooner rather than later. So what propulsion technologies are currently under consideration? There are currently five different types of wind propulsion technologies under consideration, each at various stages of development and implementation, and each presenting their own sets of advantages. Wind turbines, sail-based systems featuring soft, fixed, and kite sails are already in operation, followed by the Flettner rotor, the world's top-performing wind propulsion system currently on the brink of commercialization. The Flettner rotor is a cylinder with disc end plates, which is spun along its long axis, and as it passes at right angles across it, an aerodynamic force is created. So let's look at a couple of recent advances and concept vessels utilizing wind power for marine transport vessels. MS Beluga Skysails is partially kite powered using traditional diesel engines as its primary source motivation and a computer controlled 1,722 square foot parachute to help things along. This was created by Hamburg, Germany based Skysails. They hope that the system will reduce the ship's daily fuel consumption by as much as 35%, which is dependent on wind conditions, of course. Drax, the Smart Green Shipping Alliance, and Dry Bulk Cargo Transporter Ultra Bulk, as well as Humphreys Yacht Design, are exploring options for retrofitting existing vessels with sails, fitting an inventive sail technology called Fast Rig onto ultra bulk ships. These are importing biomass into the UK and will hopefully cut both carbon emissions and costs. Smart Green Shipping Alliance's plan is to launch a 100% renewable powered ship in 5 years' time. This retrofitted ship would be powered by waste-derived liquid biomethane to power off-the-shelf gas engines and future automated sail technology. The Ocean Bird concept is based on a car carrier able to transport around 7,000 cars. When sailing at an average speed of 10 knots, it will take 12 instead of 8 days to cross the Atlantic and reduce emissions by 90%. The wind rigs are adapted to a 200 meter long and 240 meter wide cargo vessel. The height of the wings will be able to be reduced, which will come in handy when passing under bridges or if the surface area needs to be reduced due to strong winds. The vessel will also be equipped with an auxiliary engine powered by the best alternative still under consideration. This is aimed to be sailing by 2025. So as you can see, movement in the industry is already well underway, and this is just in the area of wind power. So to tell us more, I would like to now introduce Derek Ellett, the CEO of Go Sail Cargo. Now, Derek was born into a family of seafarers precisely 9 months after his father returned from North Atlantic duties in 1946. His childhood was spent messing about in boats, including one memorable visit to the Viking Ship Museum in Roskilde, Denmark. At that time, Thames barges and Dutch schooners were still trading under sail, sowing the seeds for his lifelong association with working craft and traditional rigs. In the 1960s, Derek studied fine art, sanded the family sailing dinghy, and learned all about cabinet making and boat building. Moving to Australia in the 1980s, he founded Scruffy Marine in 1990 with the aim of building traditionally rigged small boats that incorporated modern thinking with a neat twist. They were available as revolutionary slot system kits for home completion. His Stornoway 18 made her public debut here at the museum 2 decades ago. The Secret 20 also shown for the first time at the museum. Both are still in production and new evolutionary versions will soon be manufactured for Sydney. The new boats will feature Scruffy Marine's innovative Australian-built retractable electric pod drives. With their retrofitted solar electric Secret 33 ferries as a success on the Swan River in Perth, Derek began working on what was to become the range of sailing cargo ships at Go Sail Cargo. Interest in these practical evolutionary vessels is growing fast, especially in Europe and the USA. So now I would like to ask Derek to join us. Derek, if you could unmute yourself and start your video, please. I will stop sharing this screen. There we go.
Okay, can you see me?
I can see your name.
I'm clicking on start video, but the host has stopped it.
Oh, well, that sounds like that's me. So let's see if I can fix it. Okay. Well, I'm going to make you have. No. Well, this is really annoying.
Well, I can.
Let's see. I'll just maybe if I'm going to change you to the host. Let's see what happens there. Okay. Hopefully that'll work. There we go. Now, can you do it?
Okay, got it.
Fantastic. That worked.
Yes, I'm now officially a host.
Yes, you are. Now, thank you so much for joining us today, Derek. And we're really, really happy to have you here with us. And I'm just expanding this to full screen here. But I'm also just reminding everyone, you are welcome to put the any questions or comments in the Q&A. I have one here that says, please check the sound at your end. Lots of static and crackling happening. I've been told that has been answered. So hopefully, Anne, that's working better for you there. Great. All right. Well, again, welcome, Derek. Could you please begin by telling us about the work of Go Sail Cargo?
Yes, certainly. First of all, I'd like to thank the museum for your support over the years. And in fact, the James Craig was pivotal in my decision to go for sailing cargo ships, because I always wondered what a new version of the James Craig would look like. And as it turns out, it's very similar to our largest boat, which is the C-180. But thank you for the past decades working with the museum. They've been very supportive of us, and that's something that you can't put a value on, because that shows that a museum is a modern living thing rather than just a historical organization. So the work of Go Sail Cargo, in essence, the concept is very simple. Take the best of traditional sailing boats and upgrade them with the best available technology. And that's what we did with Scruffy Marine. And it works very well. They sail well, and they perform every bit as effectively as the modern boats in many ways, sometimes better. And they certainly are a lot funkier than some of the modern boats, that's for sure. The ships available right now are based on tried and tested vessels, and they utilize modern sailcloth, modern electric motors, and lots of solar. So they are low risk and based on proven technology, quite capable of achieving zero emissions because they're running on free fuel, which also means that they're very profitable. And that's something that's of interest to any backer, of course. It's got to make a buck, otherwise there's no point. And there are people in our industry who would dispute that. And I say to them, well, it's got to fit in with current infrastructure and cargo handling systems, and it's got to be profitable. Otherwise, nobody is going to touch it. It's a simple equation, really. So as a greenie, I wear my accountant's hat, which is very important. But there's two other main issues about Go Sail Cargo. Number one is that they're available now, because we're not dependent on whether a certain new technology is going to work efficiently or not. And we're not dependent on machinery to reef the sails, for instance, because the storm is not going to settle down while you fiddle around with a technical glitch on the system that reduces the canvas. So if you take those things and add a further one, and that's you develop them for mass production, much like a car is. You produce them in lots, you standardize components, you make them last of all as a kit of parts. And a kit of parts means that smaller shipyards can get container loads of keels, of hull plating, and weld them together. They may not be able to build a 100-foot sailing ship, but they can weld together a kit of parts. So in essence, that's what we're about. It's available now while we wait for other things to work themselves out.
That's excellent. Thank you for providing us with that background of you and what you do. And I think David Duval has asked for a website link, so I have just provided yours. Yep. And we do have a video of your work, which I would like to show. I think now might be a good time if I can make it happen.
Yes.
Everyone, yes. Bear with me. Yes. Let's see. So here we go. Okay.
These magnificent sailing ships are now traveling the world as sail training vessels or sitting in museum dry docks. Some, however, are returning to the seas, plying the trade that they were originally designed for, cargo transport. This is the schooner Apollonia on the Hudson River and the brig Tres Hombres in the Atlantic. 80% of the world's trade is transported around the globe by ships, mainly in containers. This form of shipping had proved to be the fastest and most efficient mode of transport for everything from building materials to food. But the shipping industry has hit a turning point, for which there is no going back. Diesel fuel for these ships will be banned from 2030 and onwards, as shipping contributes 3% of the world's carbon emissions, and there are thousands of these ships sailing every day. So to power large ships on long voyages, designers are returning to the past and designing wind-powered merchant ships. In fact, wind rotors, kites, and foil sails are already part of this new technology, but only assist in lowering the amount of fuel used. Some designs are incorporating solar as well, but at present this is nowhere near enough to power such large vessels using only solar. However, the elephant in the room seems to have been ignored. Solar-assisted sail power. The James Craig, still sailing out of Sydney, is one of the last 19th century sailing traders. These vessels were replaced with coal-powered steam engines, and then diesel. But as the world struggles to lower greenhouse gases, both of these dirty options will be replaced with new technology. Wind power is the obvious choice, and has a proven track record. Now no longer seen as too slow, but as a winning green alternative that can be solar-assisted to power the electric auxiliaries. Visionary designer and boat builder Derek Ellard has over 40 years' experience in building timber and fiberglass yachts. Over that time, he has honed his skills in producing faster and more efficient rigs and hull designs, while still maintaining traditional lines that have made his boats so popular around the world.
We pioneered a kit system for our traditional craft and went on to sell over 300. The same principle, classic boats built with modern technology, applies to our sailing cargo clippers. They're evolutionary, not revolutionary, combining the best of the old with the best of today.
Derek has also designed electric-powered ferries, such as the elegant Secret 33.
You've got something which looks and feels like it's 100 or more years ago, but in fact it is bang up to date in its underpinnings. Technically, you could run all day just on solar. You can use this boat day after day after day with no fuel costs at all.
However, for the last 4 years, Derek has turned his skills into designing sailing ships that are solar assisted and developed around container and pallet systems.
The hulls are super efficient, the rig is a modern gaff ketch, and the motors are electric. The batteries are charged by solar and propeller regeneration.
These ships look remarkably like the clippers of old. His C-180 schooner is the same size as the James Craig. But she carries 36 containers, 12 passengers, and the perfect bowsprit for selfies. These ships are not only designed to take cargo, but there's obvious tourist opportunities as well. Yet behind the scenes, modern technology is hard at work, enabling them to compete with one big advantage. The fuel is abundant and free.
We aim to mass produce them in steel, and by using off-the-shelf components, the costs are kept down. Our kit systems means that smaller yards can build their own clippers. They can take containers, pallets, or even trucks.
Unlike the huge container ships of the future that will sail the globe, Derek's designs are mostly based on inter-island transport that has been largely ignored, but is still essential to regions such as the Pacific Islands, located right on Australia's doorstep. The Pacific nations are often sited on low-lying coral reefs and in shallow waters, so rely on small vessels to transport everything from goods and produce to tourists and locals alike.
Container ships are far too big to be of any use to most islands, but our ships can get into the smallest harbours.
When diesel is no longer available, how will these small countries maintain their supply chains across large areas with no ships or trucks? Australia has this electric and battery technology now. And now is also the time to help and fill a very large hole in the market. Derek's clever, efficient designs are all based around standard container and pallet sizes and innovative methods of loading and unloading, which are essential for such small communities with little harbour or terminal infrastructure.
On our boats, the main engines are above deck, the sails, and our long-term sailmaker, Ben Kelly, has the global technology of North Sails to back him.
Any sort of modern evolution of technology still finds its place on classic boats. The good part about this technology also, especially if we're talking about sails on boats in remote locations, is because it's more like boat building technology, it can more easily be worked on by a crew member. If this was to tear in half, you could sand the surface, prepare a patch that North Sails sent to the boat or they had on the boat in their spares, and you could literally glue this back together. Remote repairs are quite a good option, where a Dacron, you can't glue to it. You've got to manually sew.
Derek Ellard has also consulted a well-respected New South Wales shipyard, Harwood Marine, who can see the potential in a range of zero-emission ships engineered for cost-effective global mass production.
We've worked through the South Pacific for about the last 30 years, and of course, it's the lifeblood. It's the lifeblood of a community, is their external freight service. I think if we step back in time, we certainly are talking about doing that with sails and using the sun to power things. All of these sorts of technologies are natural, and it only makes common sense that islanders go back to doing what islanders used to do. I think any step in that direction is a positive step.
The market's there, the plans are drawn, and the shipyard's ready to go. All it needs now is some funding. The 2030 diesel deadline is not that far away, and the future of localised shipping is now in the balance. Free fuel really is a no-brainer.
We really have to do this. We have no choice.
For more information on how your company can be involved, please contact Derek Ellard at gosailcargo.com.
So thank you, Derek. That was an absolutely fantastic video.
Thank you.
And I think let me make sure that it's not talking anymore about main deck beams. I think that's what we've gone to next there. So, so I noticed that there you had a little bit in there about the benefits of smaller vessels, but could you expand on that a little bit for us, please?
Yes, certainly. I've got some notes here. I can't refer to them. It's small yards are often dismissed as not worth the interest of a lot of people, but the fact remains is that there's a huge volume of freight transported in very small boats, and I mean boats with one pallet or one basket of fish, right up to 20, 30, 40 containers, and in between, and you have this huge untapped mass of transport, and they're all relying on diesel and petrol outboards. Now, if you were to take a small community which needs to trade with the next island across, and they are doing that in a small ship, which is efficient and costs them nothing to run because it's sail and solar, then suddenly that whole community is enriched. So that's one thing that they can do. And there's the other, another factor is that if there is, and there will increasingly be disasters of all kinds, and international aid needs to swing into action, a small ship can creep in quite close to shore. It can even be beached on the shore, and aid can be unloaded off the ship immediately. And furthermore, a well set up solar electric cargo ship can actually act as a small portable power station because it's running off the sun. So there's factors like that, so that can and swing the balance. But the main thing is that the access to these sort of ships is limited, which is why we're going for kits. If a small yard, and we have examples of this, a small yard in the Solomons, we were working with the University of the South Pacific some years back, and we were looking at the smaller yards in the Solomons being able to build these the quite big ships from a kit transported out in containers from Australia and so on. That's another aspect which is very important, because a lot of the yards can't build a big ship like that. But if it's a collection of parts, then yes, they have a chance.
So this is actually a really innovative way of providing aid as well, because not only you can provide a kit, a vessel that's reconstructed within a particular region and then utilized for transport.
It's not a ship in a bottle, it's a ship in a box.
I like that.
I think that the other thing that needs to be considered is that a community then customizes that ship. If it's always going to be loading copra and sheep or pigs or whatever, then the boat's built for that. It's not built for containers. And it's painted in the national colors, and it's a source of pride for the community. And as I said before, that if you bounce off a reef and knock a hole in it, there's usually somebody on an island with a welder who can come and fix it. Now, you can't do that with wooden ships so easily.
I was quite surprised at how many containers you could fit on board.
Yes.
That was quite hard to visualize that, and that's quite impressive. How did you make that happen?
It's basically you push the masts away far enough so that you could get one or two sets of container in it. And then you increase the width, and then you increase the depth, so that even if it's only two or three or six containers, you can stack them up just like you would on a big ship. And then you get situations where you can't stack them too high because you can't see over the top of them. And you don't want to make the wheelhouse too high because that reduces your sailing performance. So it's all these little compromises in these steps that you take to achieve that. But it has to be container friendly. There's no argument there. You start from that, and then you can work down. You can put anything in the slots that containers would normally take, but they've got to have those first.
So I'm just having a look at the questions to see if there were any chats there. So what are some things that smaller vessels can't do? And what is sort of the industry looking at to meet those needs?
Well, we can't compete with the big ones. Once you get over a certain point, maybe 1,500 tons, it's not going to work with conventional sails, which is why you need to go to rotors and kites and flatteners. There's one backed in France, there's one backed by Michelin, which is an inflatable sail, which means that reefing means turning down a compressor, which is a really neat lateral thinking way of looking at it. But for bigger ships, we have to look at a whole new different set of rules that apply. But another factor starts to creep in there. We have, as a society, we have to reconsider how much stuff we're actually importing. We have to look very carefully at, you know, getting stuff made here in Australia, using Australian produce and Australian equipment and Australian goods, rather than importing them from a cheap, low-cost country in a gas-guzzling container ship.
We learned that lesson a little bit during COVID, didn't we? When things
started
to take a little bit longer to arrive. And I think supply chains are still pretty impacted by that.
Well, they are. But I would be very sad if our ships were used to bring in containers of cheap toys for spoiled kids. And, you know, what's the point of doing that? You have to look at it in a holistic way. And you have to consider all the aspects that will impact on society as you do it. But the main point is making a start. We can do these ships now. It's not rocket science, you know. It's basic common sense, and there's not a lot of that around.
A little bit of skill in there. I mean, come on. There's a little bit of skill involved, Derek.
Okay.
A little bit of know-how. Few years of work. No, but you're right, though. I mean, I think it's an exciting thing in the sort of ocean innovation, ocean forefront connection to industry, is that a lot of these things we can actually do.
Yes.
But the general public doesn't realize that we can do them.
Yes.
Because they're just not getting funded and visibility as much as maybe they should. Feel free to disagree.
We don't have the glamour of the brand new whiz bang technology that's going to solve the problems of the human race. What we do have is the ability to examine every single component of a ship and make it better. Things like a compressor. Now, a compressor using a European Magtor system is going to use about half the power. Vesconite type bearings are going to be much more efficient than bronze. And for instance, on our ships, many of them have a dagger board. Now that dagger board can slide in and out of a HDPE plastic lined thing and slide in and out. And because it is this HDP something or other plastic, nothing sticks to it. So it's like built-in anti-foul. In other words, this dagger board will slide in and out of this thing endlessly and noiselessly and easily without having to worry about the thing jamming up. So that's an application of technology which is really welcome. And I'm certain that if ships of the past had access to this, they'd damn well use it, you know. So
that's it. Always trying to make things just a little bit better.
Yes,
and I've
a big gain through lots of incremental gains.
And that is actually how we achieve forward progress, is it not?
It is.
Maybe baby steps towards the future.
Yes.
So, I mean, do you think, like, I've been impressed at some of the talks that I've been to over the last couple of years, the little details like the dagger board that you're talking about here, where people are in the industry are really taking a close look at, say, fuels. Yes. And every tiny little bit, and cavitation, and I mean, just across the whole scope, the industry seems to be trying to say, well, how do we save time and money and the environment altogether at once here with this. Yeah, it's a big game.
Yes, once again, it's an incremental thing. Now, I design with a pencil and paper because I'm an ancient mariner, but I will then, when I've got to a point where I'm happy with it, I will hand it over to a young whiz kid with a ponytail who will then, furiously play with a keyboard and work out optimization of the hull, you know, optimization of reduction of cavity when the propellers are going, and so on and so forth. So you look at all those things and you study them carefully, and then you start to think laterally. For instance, you look at stabilizers. If you've got passengers on that ship and the ship is rolling in a seaway, what the hell is stopping you putting stabilizers on it? For starters, stabilizers are going to make your passengers happy. Secondly, it's going to make the ship more efficient. And thirdly, it can also be used to reduce heeling, and so on. So these are just a few of the things that we're looking at. And these are some of the things which society as a whole needs to do, because it's utterly pointless having not casting aspersions on the James Craig, but the James Craig is a historic ship, and it's a beautiful ship, but it will roll in a seaway and it will be fairly slow unless the conditions are optimum. And it's simply not going to work as a business module. So you take the best of the James Craig, modernize it and make the hull more efficient. And you could reduce the weight of the rig by 50%. which means you can cram on more sail or simply heel less and so forth. It's a complex set of parameters here.
But thank you for touching on them for us. And Derek, we have a question from the audience, if you're up for it.
Certainly.
A question from Colleen. Colleen asks, in developing the concept and design, did you look at the tradition of Panisi, and forgive me if I say that wrong, shipping and building in Sulawesi at all?
No, not at all, is the quick answer. I have drawn on shipping as a sort of an amateur historian. I've looked at ships from all over the world. I've looked at lateen rigged ships in the Mediterranean. I've looked at square sails. I've looked at schooners, but not those particular ships, no.
Well, thank you. And our time is winging away from us. So I would really like to ask you, Derek, a warm and positive question. Can you see anything positive for the future of marine transport?
Yes, I can. I can see it rests in the younger generations. I'm absolutely blown away by the enthusiasm and the elevated consciousness of so many young people. Young people like Greta Thunberg, standing up there and telling a room full of suits just, you know, what they're doing wrong is amazing. And the more young people grow up with this can-do attitude, this ability to go way beyond what is decent and proper for children to do, that's the kind of attitude that's going to make big results. And I think there is in society, I see it and I sense it in society, there's a growing growth in consciousness, a growing realization that we can't go on the way we're doing this. We have to get away from the excesses of capitalism and greed and think in a more cooperative way. Now, this may seem that I'm an old socialist, and that would be absolutely right, but I'm an old socialist with a green entrepreneur's hat on, an accountant's hat on, because it makes sense. And if we nurture that power that is growing in the young people and encourage it and say to them, yes, you can do this. There's nothing to stop you. You go ahead and do it and we'll back you. Then I, as one of the first of the baby boomers, will be pleased, because at least they're taking up the cudgel and you know, giving it to those who deserve it. And I'm not mentioning any names here.
I mean, isn't it usually the banner and you've gone straight for the cudgel? It is very good for us to have hope for our future. I think that's what's going to cause the most forward movement and give us the most opportunity. Innovation, creativity.
Yes.
You can't really create if you're just feeling depressed and sad. I mean, you can maybe sometimes. Anger creates as well, but creating towards a vision.
Indeed, but if you were to encourage the growth of creativity and encourage the growth of an environment which is conducive to creativity, conducive to problem solving, that's one of the key things here. And I do this with my students. I teach them basic things like how to relax, how to breathe, how to think, you know, how to not get hung up about, you know, the latest failed love affair and so on, you know. And these things are while they may loom large in a young person's life, if they can just take a step back and say, okay, what am I going to do about it then, you know? So
I think that's a great spot to wrap up on. Let's create an environment for innovation and change.
Indeed.
And the work that you're doing is firmly within that area. And I am delighted that you are able to join us here today. And I hope that we can host one of these vessels at the museum sometime very soon in future. And all of you online can come down and see it in person. So before we go, are there any burning questions that anyone has for Derek? Because this is your last chance. Okay, great. Well,
better be quick. He's going to go and have a cup of tea any minute now.
Cup of tea time. It absolutely is. Thank you again so much for joining us. It's been an absolute pleasure. And we have a congratulations and good luck to you. Really impressive technology from one of the audience members. So thank you, Linda. And thank you again. And may you all have a beautiful Tuesday evening.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you all.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye.